The Republican Party has one go-to strategy to win elections: hate. They tell their supporters that they have to hate immigrants, minorities, women, liberals, and the government because all they know how to do is spread hate. So maybe we need to start calling the GOP a hate group. For more on this, let's go to journalist Daniel Denvir. So Daniel, the Republican Party, as you say, has put down the dog whistle and picked up the megaphone. Now, is it possible that all of this hateful rhetoric coming from the Republican Party is having a negative effect on the country?
Yeah, I mean, I think that it's all pretty toxic. But what I wanted to make sure of in my recent piece was putting it in some context, because it's not like toxic, racist, or bigoted demagoguery is new to American politics in general or the Republican Party in particular. As I mentioned, I think it was in 1990 or thereabouts when Jesse Helms in his successful Senate re-election campaign put out an incredibly racist campaign ad that showed a white hand crumpling up a job rejection notice. And I think it was a voiceover saying he didn't get a job because it went to a less skilled, you know, minority or something of the sort. I mean, in a sense, the entire modern Republican Party is built on racism. If you go back to the, you know, early and mid 20th century, you have a New Deal coalition that, you know, presided over by FDR that sort of untenably includes segregationist Southern Democrats. And when the Black Freedom Movement forces the Democratic Party's hand to embrace civil rights, they lose those white Southern segregationist Democrats like Strom Thurmond, like Jesse Helms, who then, become Republicans mostly. So the Republican Party has depended on racist sentiment for a long time. I do think, that the degree to which we're seeing, you know, open suggestions of that Muslims should have to be registered in databases, that we should have a religiously discriminatory litmus test in terms of what refugees we allow into this country, that this sort of, it's being put most extremely by people like Donald Trump, but sort of ratified in a slightly less extreme fashion by the so-called establishment, people like Jeb Bush.
Well, you know, it seems like every probably 50 to 60 years, the political parties reinvent themselves in a way. And so since, you know, the 40s to 60s, the Republican Party's new foundation kind of became this overtly but covertly racist, you know, that's what we're built upon. We're going to pick up all the Southern states that are still angry about desegregation. And so now today we see almost another reinvention where they're taking that the racist foundation and elevating it to a new level, because now it's not just African Americans. Now it is, we have to discriminate against all Muslims. We have to discriminate against non-Christians in general. Back to minorities, Hispanics, anybody coming from the southern border, really. And so it is, it's now at the forefront. It's no longer a, you know, thing in the back burner where it's like, yeah, we're a little bit racist here. Now it is, it's the rallying cry. It really has become just the new mantra of the party. We're not going to hide it. We're going to embrace it. We're going to wear it proudly. And unfortunately, it really does seem to be working for them right now, doesn't it?
Well, I mean, I think it seems to be working in terms of rallying certain parts of the Republican base. And I think it's, you know, certainly possible that Donald Trump could be the Republican nominee. Fortunately, I don't think it is possible that someone like Trump could ever win a general election in this country. I mean, the one piece of good political news in these very disturbing, calamitous times is the demographic shifts taking place in the country. And this is exactly what aspects of Trump's basers are terrified about, is this coming white minority. Fortunately for progressives, that signals that a strong likelihood that Republican, the coming white minority, signals a strong likelihood that Republicans will ultimately be put into a permanent political minority. So, and I think you see the same things when it comes to age. Millennials have much more progressive positions, not only on social issues, but also on economic issues than older generations. So I think though we see incredible Republican political power at the moment, you know, the US House and Senate, and less covered, but equally as important almost, in state houses around the country, Republican dominance. I think we're seeing sort of such an intense push to the right at their sort of like last moment in power. I don't think.
Well, I think right now what we're seeing too is it's not just, you know, this inflammatory rhetoric of the people that are running for president. That's bad enough as it is. But we also, as you pointed out, you know, we have to look at state houses, too. They are terrified of losing their majorities. And so that's why we're seeing this, you know, fevered push to gerrymander these districts into ways that, you know, yes, the minority populations are growing, but we're going to keep them out of the electoral process by gerrymandering them and not letting them have a voice. And when that doesn't work, we're going to put in place these voter ID laws that disproportionately affect minorities, and we're not even going to let them get to vote if they are in an area that hasn't been gerrymandered to death. So it's not just what they say, it is what they're doing. I mean, we're seeing policies like this popping up all over the place, especially when it comes to the Black Lives Matter movement. They are acting like this entire Black Lives Matter movement, they're treating them as if they're terrorists. You know, they want to vilify these people rather than accept the fact that, look, maybe we do have a problem with our police forces. And so I think the policies themselves are bad enough. And then when you add in the things that Trump is saying and Carson and Ted Cruz and Rubio, and that just takes it to a whole nother level there.
Yeah, I mean, I think in 2010, you really saw, after their Tea Party-backed Republican sweep of state houses nationwide, Republicans took really effective advantage of that in terms of gerrymandering congressional districts to ensure a majority. There's also a more kind of banal, sinister problem, which is baked into kind of like the very geography of the current American political divide, which is a little less sexy than gerrymandering, but is just as, if not more, serious, which is that because of the way we draw congressional districts in this country, Democratic voters are increasingly likely to live in major cities and metropolitan areas, while Republican voters are more likely to live in the exurbs and rural areas. So even the most fairly drawn districts are going to be unfair to Democrats because of the non-representative way that we draw districts in this country. So you're going to have a lot of Democratic districts that are, you know, 90% Democratic voters, like I'm guessing here in Providence where I just moved, and certainly in Philadelphia where I lived until recently. And you'll have a lot more Republican districts that are, you know, maybe more like 60% Republican, 40% Democrats. You see that a lot in terms of the districts in the Philadelphia suburbs. So gerrymandering makes it way worse. But because we have such an unrepresentative system in this country, it's going to take a while for the coming demographic changes to have their full impact felt in our political system. I mean, I believe it was as recently as 2010 that a majority of Americans actually voted for Democrats for Congress, for the House, but they got a Republican House. So there's going to be a lag in between those two things happening. And that's unfortunate because there's a lot of stuff that we can't wait on, just watching what's going on in Paris right now and Republicans demagoguing against President Obama's attempts to pledge greenhouse gas reductions. I mean, in terms of global warming, we just don't have a lot more time.
Well, as you pointed out, this racist rhetoric from the Republicans, it can win them the primaries, but when it comes to, in terms to the general election, not a winning strategy. So hopefully the American public will stand up to this, and maybe once again after the 2016 elections, the Republican Party will look back at itself and say, hey, where did we go wrong? Oh, it's the racism. Maybe we need to find a new path. Daniel Denvir, thank you very much for talking with us today.
Thank you.